Dear students and friends, welcome to this session. The topic of this session is the introduction to open and distance learning. Most of you must be familiar with the open and distance learning or the terms like distance education, correspondence education, etc. In today's brief session, I may not be able to do the comprehensive introduction to the distance learning, but I will try to certainly introduce the few important concepts and the renowned thinkers behind these concepts and a few of the practices how the distance education institutions follow. Let us start with the familiar terms which you must have heard it: the correspondence education, the word distance education, the word open education, online education, technology based education, MOOCs, etc. Let us discuss one by one. Correspondence education, which is a very familiar term to most of you, is, if you take the world scenario, it is about 175 years old concept, correspondence education. If you are familiar with at least the previous generations or the older generations are very familiar with the word shorthand courses which you used to learn, which that is a Isaac Pitman is a very renowned person who started the Pitman shorthand courses, teaching shorthand through correspondence or the postal tuition, that is what he used to call. So that was how he introduced a bit skill based shorthand courses, teaching at a distance in various parts of the world through the correspondence, that is the postal tuition, by using the simple postcard as a medium between him and the learners who are enrolled for the shorthand courses. And after that, this correspondence method or the mode is followed by the teaching to the soldiers, particularly in the former USSR, United Soviet Socialist Republic, to teach their soldiers the lessons, the training, the knowledge, etc. They used extensively the correspondence education method. After that, quite a few companies in the world, particularly industrial and business houses, used the correspondence method to teach their employees and to enhance their knowledge and to enhance the skills through the correspondence education. They used to prepare a modules in the particular subject and then send it to the soldiers or send it to the employees, so where through that they used to train them. So this is how the correspondence education or the correspondence mode was followed in various sectors. And of course, education immediately followed the suit. When others are using that correspondence method very effectively, why not the education can use that? That is how it started. When you come to the Indian scenario, the correspondence education started way back in 1962. You know that University of Delhi, the first institution, started the correspondence courses. And of course, at that time there was a demand for higher education. The conventional institutions were not in a position to absorb the complete pass out from the school stage and who are ready for the undergraduate courses or the college education. So that is how the government came out with an alternative as the correspondence institution or correspondence education, 1962. Of course, when it started, there was a skepticism all over the education sector, education people who are involved. They used to look at it, what type of teaching is possible through correspondence education, is it a credible, is it academic standards are maintained, what type of quality. Of course, in spite of all those things, government pushed that idea of correspondence education. 1962, we started with, as I told, University of Delhi. After that, of course, the other university followed is Punjabi University, Patiala, that started with the correspondence education. And the third institution started is the Punjab University, Chandigarh. After that, quite a few universities, conventional universities, started the correspondence education. That's how, of course, there are the limitations to this one. And of course, people used to see that more and more students are enrolled in these type of courses, particularly started with the humanities and social sciences courses, BA and BCom, the naturally students are enrolled. But what type of material is given is a questionable aspect. Is it material is designed for the learners who are enrolled in for this program? There are quite a few issues came. And then from there, the thing started moving towards the distance education, how this concept emerged it. If you take the world scenario, I think it was the time, of course, University of South Africa was the first distance teaching institution in that sense, but the concept gained, distance education concept gained with the establishment of the UK Open University in the year 1969. I think that was the turning point in the history of education, or particularly distance education in the world. I think even 1969, when UKWA was established, I think that institution was also faced the criticism by the education policy makers and education thinkers and the educationists in general, telling that what type of teaching, what type of education you are going to provide this open university. I think the ruling party in the at that point of time in the UK taken all those criticism to their stride, but they moved ahead with the idea and they established the UK Open University. I think they maintained the quality and they proved that they are no way different, or though no way inferior to their when it comes to the quality of education. I think the success of that UK Open University, I think gave a impetus or the strength to the rest of the world to follow that. I think that's how the most of the open universities came in the other parts of the world, particularly in the developing countries, by taking that as a role model, UK Open University as a role model. If you say the Indian scenario, I think first open university was established in the year 1982, that is AP, Andhra Pradesh Open University. Of course, now it is renamed as Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University, but it was modeled on the lines of the UK Open University. I think the founders of the AP Open University visited the UKOU, and they have taken the experiences of that and followed, try to implement, try to integrate those experiences in the running of the AP Open University. And after that, it was 1985, the establishment of IGNO, Indira Gandhi National Open University. I think you can say that with all the experience of the UK Open University was followed, adopted to the conditions of the Indian scenario, and IGNO modeled a large extent on that. In the initial years, the many experts from UK Open University visited IGNO, interacted with the IGNO faculty and the staff, so that the what type of modifications are needed to the practices that are followed at UK Open University. So in that sense, the UK Open University, establishment of UK Open University, was the turning point in the distance education history of the world. It is a milestone in that sense, which provided the real strength to the expansion of this system. I think, of course, I will explain little later how the conceptually the correspondence education is different to the distance education. Both are a mode to impart education at a distance. I think when you see the third concept, that's what is open education. When you see the correspondence distance or a mode of education or the medium to impart education at a distance, when you talk about the open education, it is not a mode of education, it is a philosophy, it is a openness. What you call open education is how to overcome the limitations of the conventional system, you call, or when you are imparting the distance teaching, there will be quite a limitation. What type of students you are enrolled for a particular program, what should be the duration of the program, and how long the program should be there, what should be the entry qualification for the program. And if you restrict those things, naturally those criteria, the variables will be a hurdle in enrolling the student. And distance education institution, by using the openness or the open education philosophy or the flexibility, relaxing those rigidities and then following that is what is a openness or open education philosophy, to make to overcome the hurdles or the limitations, so that you can impart the education to the larger groups across the boundaries. That is what is the openness or open education concept. After that, you are all familiar with the present concept, that is the present term which you keep listening: e-content, e-learning, online education, online courses. There is it's online education. E-content is, of course, following the principles of the distance education. When it comes to the design, when it comes to the delivery, only thing is the extent of the involvement or extent of the dependent in the delivery mechanism is the technology based. I think that you extensively using the technology, whether e-content programs or online programs, naturally you are developing the material, you are designing the courses and delivering the courses. Particularly it is the delivery mechanism which has taken the extensive use of technologies or ICTs. I think that's the basically, of course, this is picking up a momentum, online education all over the world, and Indian scenario is gradually catching up. Of course, the government of India, particularly the University Grants Commission, wants to come up with a very, very comprehensive guidelines how to design and offer online programs. So naturally, they want to maintain a credibility for these programs. They want to maintain the quality standards for these programs. That is the reason UGC is coming out. Once the UGC comes out with those guidelines, most of the institutions who want to go for the online program, they have to follow. And of course, the latest concept is the MOOCs, massive open and online courses. I think this is another important project taken up by the Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of India. And of course, and many institutions are coming forward designing and offering the online programs. This is where the MHRD is giving an emphasis to the MOOCs programs, and of course the extent of the involvement of Indira Gandhi National Open University also is a tremendous in this one. They involved quite a few institutions like CIC, Consortium of Education Institutions, CEC, and then University Grants Commission, IGNO, and then IITs and other institutions are with the MOOC program, and they have distributed the, particularly for the IGNO, it is given the certificate and diploma programs designing and offering through MOOCs. I think many colleagues have started that one. So naturally it will be the a concept which will take grain in the coming years and picks up a momentum and offering the to the programs to the large number with the help of extensive use and involvement of technologies for the delivery mechanisms. Let us move to the second slide. Basically, it is whatever I presented that is explained in this particular table which you are looking at it. Extension of conventional education are imparting, of course, correspondence education, as I told that, and to cope with the larger large demand for the programs, and naturally enrolling the students in the correspondence, and naturally increasing the enrollment and offering the programs, and of course certification is the ultimate item, correspondence education. When it comes to the distance education, the goals or the objectives of distance education is, it is basically a pedagogical consideration than the enrolling in the large number. That's the basic difference. Is pedagogical consideration is little less when it comes to the correspondence education or the correspondence institution designing of the programs or the goals of those programs. When it comes to distance education, pedagogic consideration, where you build the teacher in the material, teaching material, whether it is a self-learning material, whether it is a material you are developed through the electronic gadgets, audio programs, how to build the teacher in that one is the core concern in the design of the distance education programs, and naturally, of course, through that imparting the education programs to their large numbers across the things. So maintaining some sort of a credibility by giving equally the pedagogical consideration which are common for the classroom situation as well. That is the core difference from the correspondence education to distance education, designing the programs, keeping the pedagogical consideration and the needs of the learner. That is the basic difference between correspondence and distance education. I am not telling that correspondence institutions are not having the pedagogical consideration, but those have to be reflected and large extent in the initial years. Of course, there are changes taking place in the corresponding institution that it is program offered through them, but large extent earlier initial years, the pedagogical consideration and the support needed for the distance learners are not there in the corresponding education. That is where you can see the evolution from the correspondence through distance is a pedagogical consideration and the learner requirement, and the design of the program is focusing to this consideration. The third one, as I have already explained, the open education is the how to overcome the limitations of the system. So the limitations can be in terms of, as I said it, the duration, in terms of the combination of the courses, in terms of attendance, in terms of examination. Take any component which is involved in the teaching learning process, how to overcome so that you facilitate. Naturally, open education is a very flexible concept and a very dynamic concept, provided how you use that, how you integrate the openness in the design of the program. When it comes to the second thing, that is the methods, as I said it, correspondent education, it is a large extent used a printed material, or some cases it is not even a printed. In the initial years, they used to have a handwritten material. They used to give a some sort of a cyclostyle material. Many of you may not be familiar with the word cyclostyle, but that was the concept, that was the thing used. In the using a typewriter, you cut the stencils and cyclostyle those things with the help of a machine and send it. So naturally, it is not aimed at or designed at with the distance learners needs in that. That is the limitation, you can say, in that system, and that material is sent through the postal system to the student. When it comes to the distance education, as I said, the pedagogical consideration, the total design is focused to the distance learners requirements. The multimedia, that is where more than one medium is used, multi-media, multiple media, whether it is a print material, whether it is audio programs, whether video programs, whether it is other electronic devices are used more than one medium is mixed up and used and offered to the students. That is where the distance education strength lies it. In addition to that, whatever the media, combination of media you are using it, the human element, that is the one important. Many educational thinkers, which I will explain little later, focus that unless you bring the human element and contact in the design of the program, naturally you will not be justifying, you will not be able to justify that it is a teaching learning program. When I explain the concept of the thinkers of the distance education, you will be able to get clarity on that. So human element is brought in the distance education delivery mechanism through the wide network of the support services. So that's where in the case of correspondence education, the student support services network was not available initially. But gradually, many institutions realizing the importance, if you want to give the credibility to your own institution, you have to provide the student support services, that gradually they are following it. As I said, that open education, what are the broad things which you follow is, I think, instruction, how you are providing the instruction, whether it is one media or the more than one media you are using it, pertaining to admissions, whether it is a entrance test, whether it is the any limitation for the entry qualifications, or you are opening it for everybody, and that duration of the program, as I have already told, how many examinations the student can give it, and how many subject combination of subjects, or the wider you provide a number of courses in a big basket and ask the student to choose out of those basket according to their choices and interest and consideration, and that's where the openness follows it. I think, as I said, that quite a few concepts I explained during this elaboration of this table. Let me say that the very renowned distance educators or educationists or thinkers in the area of distance education start with Michael Moore, the very renowned distance educator of the United States of America. He was in Pennsylvania University. He was the editor of American Journal of Distance Education, a very eminent distance educator who worked in the area of distance education. His emphasis, if you call a teaching learning process without communication between the teacher and the learner, it is incomplete. How you provide that? You provide, whether it is through face to face, whether you provide through the other electronic gadgets, you plan yourself. When you say that, his emphasis is this interaction between the teacher and the learner is not only the important in the conventional system, it is equally important in the distance education system. So this is a message to the distance educator practitioners, how you are going to involve, how create this teaching learning interaction. That is where the focus is, how you create academic interaction. Basically, it is an academic interaction. That is where he said that it is a particular, basically a dialogue between the teacher and the learner. How you create this dialogue? So he is sure that the dialogue can be effective in the face-to-face situation. But it does not mean that you every time you have to go for, when you visualize the distance education program, you can use that, whether with the help of audio, with the help of telephone, with the help of other technology, you do create the interaction between the teacher and learner. That is where his emphasis is on that. It is basically the concept of dialogue is a very powerful to create an academic interaction. So this is a very good point one has to note down. Any distance educators, when they are designing the new programs through distance learning. The other idea of the Michael Moore is the structure. So one is the dialogue, other one is the structure. Particularly with the teach yourself material or the self learning material or the other ways which you are providing that. So naturally these are all structured one. So the scope for dialogue is less and is more. When it comes to the contact class, when it comes to the tutorial session, scope for dialogue is more, the structure is less. When it comes to the teach yourself material or others where the structure will be more. So how you balance this between a dialogue and structure is the focus of the Michael Moore's concept of distance education. And the other important thing, as I said when I am explaining the distance education methodology or the multimedia approach followed to the distance learning, David Sivert is another renowned distance educator who has extensively worked in the area of how to provide the support services to the distance learner through various means. I think his emphasis particularly on the continuous concern for the student, how you as a distance educator, how you as a distance education institution maintain a contact with the distance learner. That is, a continuous contact is very important. If you are not in continuous touch with your learners, naturally you will not be able to justify yours as an institution, you as a distance educator. This is a continuous concern for the student through various mechanisms is the focus of the David Sivert. And the third distance educator, Otto Peters, from the Germany, who has extensively worked in the distance education concept and practices, he came out that because when you enroll a large number of students, when you create a teaching learning design for the large number of learners and using various educational technology and various ICTs and the support services, the whole operation is rightly said that it is some sort of, he compared with to that of the industrialized operations which you observe in industry or a business organizations. Yes, he is rightly said when it comes to the operation, it is an industrialized form of education, but at the same time you cannot ignore the academic consideration, pedagogical consideration when you are offering the education through the large numbers in the industrialized form. That is the focus of Otto Peters. And finally, there is another the renowned distance educator, Homburg. In 1981, he highlighted that a self-study of the self through the self-learning material by the distance learner. I think when you develop a self-learning material, when you give it to the student, naturally student depend on that one. So naturally they may not be able to contact, but he focused that how you create interaction through the self-learning material or the self-study. I think that is the focus of that, how you create interaction between a tutors and who have written the material and the learner. So that is where the you inbuild the teacher into that one, create some sort of a dialogue. Can you, if you are able to do that, that is where that it is what in that sense is the interaction between the learner and authors who have written the material. That is what he termed as a guided didactic conversation. Can you develop this guided didactic conversation through the materials for the using it for the self study? I think fairly enough. So these are the few renowned thinkers of distance educators concepts which are very valuable whether you still follow the correspondence education or distance education with the help of openness of this one. Let us move to the next slide. So if you follow all those things, really you can achieve the objectives which you can see in the slide. In the slide, I think the major objectives of that, there are quite a few others which can be enlisted into that one. It is a very serve as a cost effective model. I think that is where, as I said, industrialized, when you enroll a large number of students, when you offer this to the same program to larger groups and large numbers, actually you can achieve the economies of scale that becomes a cost effective education. Of course, initial investment will be heavy, whether designing the program, developing the material, whether it is self-learning or the technology based material. It is not easy initially, it will be intensive, both the time and the resources intensive. And once you develop the material, the same material can be used for the larger number of learners, that becomes the, you can achieve the economies of scale. And then of course, this is a system which is flexible and very dynamic, provided you follow those principles in designing the program. So that is where the one of the major first objective is that. The second one is to provide self-paced open learning opportunities. I think that is where you offer the concept, you offer the program to the student and you give the flexibility in the system, in the design of the system, design of the program, or design of the courses. So naturally learner paced his learning according to his opportunities, according to his convenience. If you build those features in the program, you are providing the student to face his learning according to his convenience. If you are not providing that scope, naturally he cannot pace it. So, how you design the program initially is the in the distance educator's hand. And the third principle is to serve as a channel for lifelong learning. I think that is where the very important that the present the importance of the in the world is that one. How? Because things are changing very fast, whether it is in the conventional system, whether it is in the one discipline, whether it is in technology, humans, everywhere the things are changing fast, the content is changing fast, the skills are new skills are emerging. So, naturally it was like unlike earlier where once you achieve a degree and for the rest of the life you do not need any additional knowledge or the skill. That concept is outdated now and the things are changing fast. Younger generation are looking for whatever the knowledge and skills acquired through a program, through a degree or a diploma will be outdated within no time in the changing scenario of the society in general. So, naturally for continuous learning, the scope for lifelong learning, the distance education is providing a very effective alternative. I think you can see the profile of enrollment across the distance education institution where many students are offering that while doing the job, while serving the form, so that they can enroll into the programs and earn the new knowledge and learn the new knowledge and the new skills are acquired. I think the fourth objective is to retrain the workers who have already into the system, whether it is a company or industry. Naturally, after a period of time, they becomes a little outdated or obsolete. So, naturally, if you want to give the new knowledge and the skills, you cannot call all of them to a classroom and start teaching the new knowledge and methods. And unless you use the distance education methodologies and workers retraining is very effective. So, these are the broader objectives along with quite a few other objectives. It gives away the access to the large number across the length and breadth of the country. So, that is where I will conclude that the futures of distance education is very important, emanating out of the objectives which I talked about earlier is large number. I said that is why any distance education program cannot be visualized that I am going to offer this program for a 40 students or a 50 student. If it is a 40-50 students, it is better to have a classroom based design rather than the distance education. So, large number of enrollment is the one of the key features of distance education and provide the accessibility. Yes, I think this is where Indira Gandhi University headquarters at the Delhi, and we are offering the programs to the every corner of this country and the beyond the country also we are offering the program. So, accessibility in terms of geographically isolated areas etcetera is the providing the accessibility. I think this is the distance education can reach the any corner irrespective of the geographical terrain, irrespective of a language, irrespective of religion, race, caste and creed. So, that is the strength of the distance education. Third important feature of distance education I would like to highlight is it deals with the individual learners. As I explained earlier, the total design of the program considering the learners of distance needs, naturally when you design those features, it automatically gives a scope for each individual learner. I think that is where otherwise you have a you may get a doubt that when you enroll thousands of students, how can you pay attention to each individual. But that is where that by following the concepts which I explained so far, you design a program that will lead to the attention of each individual learner. So, other important feature is using expertise of many academics. That is the strength of the distance education. If you involve the best teachers, who is teaching the classrooms, who is teaching in various institutions, if you bring them together in designing the program, in developing the program, in delivering the program, naturally you are making use of the expertise of many academics in a particular subject, in a particular discipline, and you are providing that quality teacher to the large number of learners. That is the key strength of the distance education, utilizing the resources, expertise of the many academics. I think this is not possible in any classroom situation, but certainly it is possible in the distance education scenario. And the third, the fourth important feature of the distance education is using the power of the media. The one example is you are listening to me through this video program, and this is how the various media ICTs are used in delivering the distance education program. I think that is the strength. naturally the bringing many teachers, involving them in various design, various audio programs, video programs and teleconferencing sessions, naturally the power of the media is extensively used, exploited, so that a learner in the different places, distance learner located in the different places, will get the use, exploit the strength of this media. This is how, this is from the beginning, how you design the program with the help of the media available and by extensively using the ICTs in the offering of the program, distance learning program. The last feature what I highlight, I would like to mention, is that once you follow the concepts which I explained, the practices which you have designed, and naturally if you follow all those principles, you may not provide the best program on the earth, but certainly you can say that it is the one of the first rate programs available for the distance education learners. That is how the, it yields to a first rate program when you design all distance education programs considering the futures I explained in this one. Thank you very much for patient hearing. All the best. Thank you.